visit her birthplace, learn all about the initial search, which involved an aircraft carrier, and look at the ongoing search. Be sure to check it out. We want this live chat to be your program. First, let us know what questions you have about aircraft carriers. We will get to as many of those questions as we can. Also, let us know where you're watching from. We'll be giving shout outs throughout the show. And if you want to help us out, we've put a survey in the comments. Today, we are extremely happy to be joined by Captain Kavon Hakimzadeh, Director of Aircraft Carrier Requirements in the Office of the Chief Naval Operations, and was previously the commanding officer of the aircraft carrier, the USS Harry S. Truman. Captain, thank you so much for joining us today.
Oh, fantastic to be here, Beth. Thank you very much. It's a not so beautiful day, but things are exciting here at the Udvar-Hazy. We got a bunch of crowds out here, and we are certainly soaring together.
I am so glad that you were able to get out there today. The snow, I don't drive in the snow. So that is why we are doing this online, but we are so happy to have you. Let's start by just asking, you have lived on many ships and you were the commanding officer of the USS Harry S. Truman aircraft carrier. Tell us a little bit about what life is like on board an aircraft carrier. What is your day-to-day routine?
Yeah, and that's a really good word for it, routine. You know, an aircraft carrier is huge. You know, everybody, especially U.S. aircraft carriers, U.S. super carriers, as we like to call them. They're so big that we actually call them, you know, the rest of the world calls them super carriers because they're so big compared to even, you know, other countries' aircraft carriers. But it's, there's 5,000 people living together, and routine is a really good word. You have to, there's a daily routine, you know, of how we do business, everything from waking up and, you hear an announcement in the morning to wake up, getting ready to get to work, feeding everybody, and then starting the day revolves around, you know, flying airplanes. So starting the fly day, getting the airplane started up, launching airplanes, and recovering them an hour and a half later and launching another set of airplanes. Up on the activities on the flight deck occurring, and everything's just a routine. Everything's a cycle. We call them cyclic operations on the flight deck. You see some pictures here flowing across of what day-to-day operations are. And even below the flight deck, you know, everybody thinks about aircraft and, you know, we're talking about a floating airport here, but there are 5,000 people on that ship and probably, 75% of them are working down below. Everything from operating the ship's propulsion plants. You know, you have two nuclear reactors on aircraft carriers that must be maintained. Lots of engineering, lots of physical plant. You know, it takes an awful lot of effort to make sure that the air conditioner is going, making sure that the 380 something toilets are working. There's a full hospital. There's a dental clinic. So you go through a daily routine, and it tends to go, 7 days a week, 24/7, even when most people are sleeping on board, there's always somebody up top driving the ship and watch. And you tend to get into a routine because when we deploy, we spend 7 to 8 months out at sea.
So it's almost like a small city with an airport is what you're running.
Absolutely. I love I think that's a perfect analogy. I mean, it is truly a self-contained city. You know, there are 7 dining facilities, 5 retail outlets. You know, I mean, you can go, you know, you got a store to buy stuff in. There's a hospital, a dental clinic, there's a police force. There's even a jail, doesn't get used very much, but there's a jail. There's an engineering plant, everything that you could possibly think of. We like to make a joke. We have everything but the bowling alley. We tend to play, that's one of our running jokes is to have the new folks go out and look for the bowling alley. But we got just about everything else.
How important are aircraft carriers to the United States military?
They are absolutely crucial. What we like to say about our aircraft carriers is they represent 4.5 acres of sovereign U.S. territory. Whenever we have to send, airplanes or troops overseas for operations overseas, with an aircraft carrier, you don't have to ask anybody's permission. And 70% of the planet is covered with water, and 80% of the world's population lives within fairly close proximity of that water. And so, if our country has a operational need, an aircraft carrier being in the area tends to it projects power, it projects confidence, it reassures our allies. It's the probably the most visible way that we can show America cares to our friends and allies, and to remind our adversaries that America cares.
Speaking of America cares, a lot of people just think of aircraft carriers as being able to move military equipment, but they're also involved in some humanitarian efforts as well, aren't they?
Absolutely. I think that that's one of the most noble things, and one of the things that really excites our sailors more than anything is, they all join to help, they all join to make a difference. And that's one of those things where you can see a tangible, positive difference made when you go support things. So absolutely, any sort of, tsunami relief or, a big storm comes through. We were down on the scene and off of New Orleans when New Orleans got hit so terribly. We were in Indonesia when Indonesia got hit, the Philippines. Not only do we bring, capacity, we can bring just cases and cases and tons of water and food. We have the transportation, we have helicopters, we have the ways to get it ashore. We have the ways to make more water. So we tend to be extremely useful when it comes to humanitarian assistance or disaster response.
We have some questions coming in. I want to remind everyone to keep those questions coming in and let us know where you're watching from. We'd love to give you a shout out. Captain, one of the questions that has just come in is, do aircraft carrier commanding officers have a chance to fly jets while in charge of the warship itself as much as the CAGs? And I'm going to ask you to start by telling us what a CAG is.
So CAG is CAG is the acronym, and it's an older acronym that we still use. It's an honorific that is bestowed upon the commander of the carrier air wing on board. So there are two kind of large entities on board an aircraft carrier. As the captain of the aircraft carrier, my crew is about 3,000 people on board the ship. And then the CAG, the air wing commander, has 2,000 people that are associated with the various squadrons of aircraft on the ship. So I'm in command of the ship. I provide, I make sure that the CAG's airplanes get launched. I make sure that the CAG's people are cared for, and that they have the facilities to do the work that they do. But the striking power of the ship, the weapon system of the ship, if you will, is the carrier air wing, and that boss is the boss of that is the CAG. And this question always shakes me up because we all start off as aviators, those of us in this business that do this. So the specific answer to his question is no, sadly no. The CAG gets to fly as much as he or she wants to. The carrier commander, she or he tend to fly, sporadically. You have the privilege of flying off your own ship, but your job is to drive the ship. Your job is to make sure the crew's taken care of. So not nearly as much fun flying as the CAG has.
Well, we've got people watching from in the Netherlands. We've got Scott from Falls Church, and Danny is sending greetings from Guatemala. Please keep those questions coming in. One of the next questions is, how long does it take to train a nuclear trained aircraft carrier command officer? I get the impression that not everyone gets selected to make it through the pipeline.
Yeah, that's a great question. It's a fairly long process. So the evolution of commanding officers for aircraft carriers being aviators started 100 years ago with the the commissioning of our first aircraft carrier. This happens to be this month happens to be the Navy's celebration of the centennial of U.S. Navy aircraft carriers. Back in March 20th, 1922, we commissioned the first aircraft carrier, USS Langley, and from that, the legislation that enabled the construction and commissioning of that platform and subsequent aircraft carriers have all called for the commanding officer of an aircraft carrier to be an aviator, to fly Navy airplanes, largely because you have to have a fundamental understanding of the mission of naval aviation in order to be able to drive the aircraft carriers. So guys like me and ladies like me who have been selected for this job tend to have had a full career flying airplanes, you know, up to about 20 years. And then you do a real radical shift to train to become the captain of an aircraft carrier. You go through the nuclear power training. The Navy's nuclear propulsion program is one of the most arduous STEM-related training programs in the United States military, up to 2 years of training. You go through Naval Nuclear Power School, where you learn the fundamentals of nuclear propulsion, everything from safety to, you know, to nuclear physics, to chemistry, to the mechanical and electrical engineering associated with that. It does get pretty hard for those of us that are selected for the carrier program, because we tend to be much older and have been away from an academic environment for a while. So we go through the exact same training as both a new enlistee or a new officer who is just out of college or just out of high school in the nuclear propulsion training program.
Go ahead, finish up.
And then just once you finish the training, you actually do several iterations of ship stuff before you're qualified to actually be the captain of an aircraft carrier. So you go and you work as the executive officer of the aircraft carrier. I like to think of that as if you think of the aircraft carrier as a city and you think of the captain as the mayor of the city, the executive officer is it's like the city manager. She's like the city manager that will make sure that the day-to-day running is going on, because the captain sits up in his chair and up in the bridge and says, go that way. But you learn that job, and then you go to a ship we call it a deep draft vessel, but a large ship as the captain that doesn't have aircraft, a non-aircraft carrier, to get the opportunity to, again, just practice driving ships, a big ship. It's a skill that you have to develop before you're finally ready. Question being posted, yes, it's difficult. It's the process from actually starting the training to being captain of a ship is probably about 7 years or so. So it's tough to get through.
Speaking of, do you want to tell us a little bit about your educational background and how you became interested in joining the Navy?
Yeah, absolutely. Out of high school, I enlisted in the Navy because I was looking for technical training, and I wasn't quite, I don't think I was quite mature enough to start college right away. And I enlisted in the Navy's nuclear propulsion program as a enlisted person. And I went through the nuclear power training, decided that I really liked the technical rigor. I liked the Navy lifestyle. While still in training, I applied for a Navy college program, the Navy ROTC program, and was selected. And focused very much, in keeping with STEM, I was focused on the technical education opportunities. So the Navy sent me to a Navy ROTC program. I got a degree in electrical engineering, and my desire to kind of continue on as engineering focused type work. I chose to start flying an airplane called the E-2 Hawkeye, which is our radar airplane. It's like our Navy's version of an AWACS, with a big dome on top, operating radars. The desire to pursue technical education early on, the opportunities presented by the Navy to be able to do that for free were big factors in my decision.
We have got people watching. Shout outs to the Chicago Great Lakes area, Ontario, Canada, Landlocked Ohio, and Carmel, Indiana. And someone, Anne, would like to thank you for your service and sharing your story today. She and her son are loving it, and they're watching in Richmond, Virginia. There are a lot of questions coming in about the new USS Ford. So can you tell us a little bit about where that is and the new innovations and how it's different from, say, the USS Harry S. Truman?
Absolutely. I'd love to do that. Because we're extremely proud of USS Ford. She is a technical marvel. A generational leap in aircraft carrier technology. It took us a little while to get to where we are. Back when we originally designed her, we took a big leap and ended up putting over 20 transformational technologies into that aircraft carrier to make her much more effective, much more lethal, she's a technical marvel. So a couple of the biggest differences and the biggest technological advances on board. One is the electromagnetic aircraft launch system, the catapults. On Harry S. Truman, which is one of the 10 Nimitz class carriers that we have in the Navy, those systems they're steam systems. And it's a wonderfully efficient system. It's a wonderfully, very dependable system. Actually designed by the British that we incorporated with the advent of, with the use of launching aircraft carriers off of jet aircraft off of aircraft carriers. We started using steam catapults, and that's what we have on the Nimitz class carrier. So you have steam produced down below. They come up into an accumulator up on the flight deck. You have the aircraft connected to a big piston that rides along a steam track, a 300 foot steam track. Steam pressure is built up to match the weight of an aircraft. The steam pressure matches the appropriate weight to be able to launch that aircraft, the aircraft releases, the steam piston pulls the aircraft down that 300 foot track, accelerates it to 120 miles an hour, and the plane is airborne with a lot of fuel, a lot of weapons, and very heavy. What happens to that piston that's traveling at about 120 miles an hour at this point is the piston slams into the front of the ship into a big water tank, a water break that stops that piston. You recycle it and you do that whole process over again. So the biggest technological leap with the Gerald R. Ford is that catapult process, that process of launching the airplane, is now done via a magnetic levitation, almost like a maglev train. A series of linear induction motors along that 300-foot track essentially pull the shuttle underneath the aircraft along on a 300-foot track. There's a great picture of the Gerald R. Ford. And it ends up doing the same thing that a steam catapult would do with, less than half the weight, no water, no need for a water tank at the front, because that piston that drags the airplane along, once it passes the linear induction motors, it stops and the airplane goes. A lot less wear and tear on the aircraft, a lot easier to maintain, a lot fewer steam piping and things that can be affected by corrosion. Lot easier to maintain, a lot fewer and a lot less manpower as well. It makes the ship a lot lighter, so you can put other things in there. The other thing that it does on the backside of the ship is catching the ship, the arresting gear. The typical arresting gear on board a Nimitz class aircraft carrier is a hydraulic system, uses a series of hydraulic rams against hydraulic pressure. You have wires across the flight deck and the hook on the back of the aircraft. The pilot will land at a position to be able to catch that wire with the hook on the aircraft, and the wire pays out. It tends to pay out about 300, just over 300 feet or so. And there's a hydraulic engine underneath that uses hydraulic rams that go up against hydraulic pressure. Slows the aircraft down slowly enough not to damage the aircraft or pull the hook off the back of the aircraft when it lands. On the Ford class carrier, that process is actually done through a series of water flywheels. You almost think of them in terms of like a rower, if you pull against a water rower machine or something. So most of that energy of the airplane landing is dissipated in a flywheel in the water type assembly. Again, a lot. Easier to maintain, a lot lighter, a lot less manpower intensive. The other thing that's really noticeable when you think about the USS Ford is, you have to kind of have side-to-side pictures of the carriers to see it, but the island of the Ford is significantly further back in the flight deck. That is to create a lot more space to be able to recover airplanes, refuel them, put new weapons on there, change out pilots, get it to the front of the ship, and launch it again. It happens just by design, just by giving that space forward of the island. You end up, a typical aircraft carrier fly day will launch, 110 to 120 sorties. Launch the airplane, catch the airplane as a sortie. Recover the airplane as a sortie. The Ford will routinely be able to do 150 to 160 and much more in times of crisis. So a significantly more capable platform that we're very excited about. She's out at, she was just out at sea finishing up. We did, I don't know if many of you had a chance to see, but part of the testing of a new aircraft carrier platform is we do shock trials. They call full ship shock trials, where we make a controlled explosion beside the ship to be able to shake it and shake some of those systems, just to see what might shake loose and see, test the design that we put into it. She just went through about 7 months ago, she went through a series of three of those big explosions by the side of the ship. She was everything that we had hoped for. She came through with everything that we could hope for as far as durability, as far as, even things that we were expecting to have to repair after that, she ended up holding up really, really well. So extremely proud of that ship. I look forward to, you'll be reading a lot about her being underway on a deployment later on this year.
That sounds terrific. I'm so glad that you were able to cover that for us. I know that we've been getting a lot of questions about that particular ship. I want to remind everybody that we are still taking questions, so please keep them coming. We have Frank from Edinburgh, Scotland saying hello. We have Wright who says, cheers, sir, from a Cold War gunner's mate living in Northwest Florida. Thank you for all that you do to keep us safe. Bravo, Zulu. And Alice in Alliance, Ohio, says that her brother was on the USS Independence back in the 80s. Thank you for all of your service. Now, you were talking about the new way to launch and land on the Ford. Tell us, what's it like launching and landing on a very fast plane on a very short runway in the middle of the ocean? Tell us about just launching and landing off the aircraft carrier.
It is the best roller coaster ride in the world. It's amazing. You go from a full stop. Again, by the time you prepare to launch, the aircraft's in full power. You're prepared for it, and you're holding up against it. But you go from a full stop to about 120 miles an hour, and it's just a couple of seconds. It's a great ride. And then on the backside, as you come back to return, you're doing about 120 miles an hour, and you catch a wire, and you very quickly slow down to zero. You hope. If you happen to miss the wire, you get to take off again, come back around and try again. The best roller coaster ride in the world. Physical fitness is a big part of being a sailor. Physical fitness is certainly a big part of being a naval aviator, because your body does take more than the average amount of stresses. It's just the coolest thing I've ever done, and I've done it about 900 times.
Marty and I did it once and I loved it. It was great. So what is something unexpected about, what is something that somebody wouldn't realize about living on an aircraft carrier? Is there something just
different? This is out to my 21st century talent out there, thinking about joining the Navy and thinking about doing this for a living. You, my friends, are absolutely dependent on technology and connectedness. You don't really realize, you know, how often you sit down and check your phone, or anytime you kind of sit still and you're connected, you're texting, you got knowledge at your fingertips. It is when we tend to pull away on a ship, on an aircraft carrier, you go back to your old school, desktop, real old school, those of you who remember dial-up kind of connectivity, a lot less connectivity, no instant information coming at you. It tends to be one of the most stressful things. You think, so we have folks that live in rooms with like 80 other people and really tight quarters, there's a great picture with, a lot of people hanging out and a lot of people coming in at all hours, kind of tough to sleep. But the most stressful thing that people deal with is being disconnected from their phones. And you tend to do it for a couple of months at a time. So you don't think about it, but it's stressful.
How do you communicate? Now, I know that I was able to drop a postcard in a mailbox.
That's right. everybody has, an email account. Everybody has the ability to, we have a series of phones. They're somewhat old school. Those of us that have been around for a while can actually recognize, something that hangs on a wall and has a receiver. You can stay loosely connected, but it is not—it's not at the pace that we're used to, especially my 21st century talent out there.
Why is it important that you don't use cell phones and personal devices on an aircraft carrier?
Because as big as an aircraft carrier is, in a combat situation, you realize that the ocean is a whole heck of a lot bigger, It's actually easy to hide an aircraft carrier, and it is tactically conducive sometimes to be able to hide that thing. People can track where your cell phones, just based on what towers you're pinging off of or what satellites you happen to be pinging off of. It is absolutely critical in a combat situation to be able to keep the ship hidden. Information is power in those kind of situations, and we don't want to give anything away. So it is, and sometimes it's just critically important to make sure that there's no cell phones trying to ping off a satellite or ping off a cell tower to give away the position of the ship.
Captain, that is all the time we have for today. I want to thank everybody who's out there serving, whether you're on an aircraft carrier or at a military base. And I want to go over just a couple of more things before we wrap today. Don't forget to check out the latest episode of STEM in 30. We're looking at the lasting legacy of Amelia Earhart. We visited her birthplace and learned about the initial search, so be sure to check it out. We also want to let you know that starting in May, you can catch our Air and Space live chats exclusively on YouTube Live. We'll be on Facebook through April, but on YouTube starting in May. So be sure to tune in on YouTube. And right now would be a great time to subscribe to the National Air and Space Museum's YouTube channel. If you enjoyed this video, be sure to follow STEM in 30 on Facebook and Twitter. We always love to hear your feedback. You can email us at stemin30@si.edu. Again, Captain, I want to thank you so much for joining us today. It has been a pleasure to talk to you. And everybody, thanks for watching.
Thank you so much, Beth. Thank you, everybody, for watching.